Welcome to KikiTV.LIFE and welcome to my expert event. And I'm so happy to be here today with Dr. Saifedean Ammous. Saifedean is an economist and author focusing on Bitcoin. He authored the first academic book on the economics of Bitcoin, the Bitcoin Standard, which has been translated into 20 languages. I've only ever read one book on economics, and that book was absolutely transformational for me. It, at a spiritual level, and that is The Bitcoin Standard by Dr. Saifedean, and I'm so happy to have you here today. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you very much for having me, Kiki. It's a pleasure.
So, before we talk about Bitcoin, which is quite difficult to understand, let's talk about what is money? What does it do? We exchange our time for money so that we can live the life that we want. What is money, and why would we understand that our money now is not safe? Our time is not safe. Our future is not safe because of the current economic situation.
Yeah, so I think, you know, to cut to the chase, in my book, I focus on one important characteristic of money, which is the hardness of the money. And in particular, that relates to how much new production can you produce of the money compared to the existing stockpiles? Or in other words, how much inflation can there be when we understand inflation as the increase in the supply? So effectively, I think that metric, you know, the percentage annual growth in the supply, is arguably the most important long-term metric in what happens to a money. It's in the fate of a particular kind of money. So, if you look historically, and I mentioned several examples in my book. Whatever gets used as money at any particular point in time, at any particular place in time throughout history, is whatever is the hardest to produce or whatever has the lowest supply growth rate. So for most of history around the world, gold was the money of choice because it is the one thing that is whose supply is very hard to increase. Similarly, you look at, we have examples of isolated little islands that don't have limestone. In these islands, they import limestone from another island, and because it's very hard to get new limestone, limestone is very rare, and so it ends up being used as money. In other places, seashells are used as money. In places that didn't have glass production, they used glass beads as money because it was very hard to secure glass beads. So whatever is the hardest thing to make ends up holding on to its value and ends up being used as money. And that's both because of a conscious decision based, a conscious decision that humans make because they choose to take the hardest money because they see that its supply can't be increased. But also, more important than that, I argue, this is a dynamic that doesn't even need humans to be conscious of it for it to unfold, because even if people were completely blind to how they allocate their money and they were to allocate it completely randomly, the forces of markets, the forces of supply and demand, and the forces of production will ensure that in the long run, only the hardest things will be used as money, because all the easy things, the things for which you can increase the supply, as their price begins to appreciate because people are using them as money, it becomes easy for their producers to make more and more of them, and so dump a larger supply of them on the market, bring the price down, and reduce the market value. So the only money that will store value in the long run will end up being the money that is the hardest to produce. And so we see that when in societies that have a money, when a harder money is introduced, you know, that the easier money dies away, it stops being used as money, no matter what anybody says or wants, just because it doesn't hold on to its value well. You know, every year the supply increases, let's say, by 10%, whereas another money has a supply increase by 5% every year. If you carry that forward for a few years, you know, the difference in magnitude of supply becomes enormous, even though it's a small percentage difference, but the magnitude difference and eventually becomes enormous, and that will be reflected in the price. So if you stored your money in the easy money, if you stored your wealth in the easy money, 10 years later, it's going to have been more or less devalued, and you won't have any wealth left, and all the wealth that's left is going to be the wealth that's stored by the people who used the harder money. So we see this even, you know, in prisons. People use cigarettes as money because you can't make cigarettes in prison and they're very hard to get. We see it even with national currencies around the world. You see that, you know, the currencies that have the low predictable supply growth rate every year, like the US dollar and the euro and the British pound, they hold on to their value relatively well compared to the currencies that have a very high supply growth rate, like the Venezuelan Bolivar and the Mexican peso and all these other currencies that continue to witness more and more inflation. It's simple supply and demand. And applying this to money, I think, is quite instructive.
So we have an idea. I have an idea that all of these paper bills or these digital money that I'm moving around to buy things in person or online, I have an idea that at Fort Knox, there's a piece of gold for every bit of money that I move around. And this is called, I believe, the gold standard. And when our money was, these paper money was created, it was like a paper IOU. I'm going to give you this 20 bucks. You're going to give me this thing. And you accept that this 20 bucks is linked to gold. And one day I could take all my money, get some gold and leave. But that doesn't exist anymore. So what we understand that gold, the gold standard, gold is hard, it is limited, or it's very expensive to produce, so each bit of it, it has a value. But now, we're not, all of our paper bills have nothing to do with gold, or very little.
Yeah, so I think, you know, eventually gold ended up being the only money in the world by around the year 1900. Even silver was practically demonetized by then, or demonetizing by then, and gold ended up winning because it is the hardest thing to produce. And I discuss why in detail and the chemistry of it in my book, The Bitcoin Standard. But when it was being used as money, you know, the inconvenient thing about gold is that you have to move it around physically, and that can be expensive. And so what ended up happening was that more and more of gold trading and gold exchanges were happening with paper currency backed by gold, or with financial instruments, digital effectively, financial instruments that are, you know, just entries on people's paper ledgers. And as long as, you know, in theory, as long as the physical quantity of gold is equivalent in value to the value of the papers that are circulating and all the financial assets that are gold substitute, that there's no problem with that. But the security failure in gold, you know, the bug, the software bug in gold as a money, is that once you put all the gold in somebody's vault and told them, you know, all right, we'll just use pieces of paper, the difference in the production cost of the piece of paper or the ledger entry, or the digital ledger entry, or and on the one hand versus the production cost of gold on the other hand are enormous. It costs a few cents to make a dollar bill. It costs $1,700 or $600 to make an ounce of gold. You know, to make $1,600 or $1,700 in paper costs practically nothing compared to the price in gold. So that mismatch has proven to be far, 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 far too tempting for governments and banks over the last couple of centuries. And as a result, you know, this culminated in 1971 when the final link between gold and the dollar was severed. Central banks still keep gold because gold is still the only money that exists that is not anybody else's liability. So this is why, you know, central banks still hold gold, because they don't want to just be holding their own paper and other central banks' papers. But there's no connection between the size of their money supply and the gold supply.
So in 1971, there were rising costs in the United States. We're coming out of, or there's this war, this very expensive war in Vietnam. The prices of gasoline are going up. And President Nixon wanted things to be more affordable for the American people. And he said, well, let's just make more of these pieces of paper, get them into people's hand. It doesn't have to be backed by gold. We're just increasing the ability for people to throw paper around and spend it. Is that what happened?
I don't think that was the motivation, the explicit motivation, but more or less that is what happened. Essentially, up until 1971, we didn't have as much gold as we had paper in circulation. And, you know, the only, but you couldn't just go and take your gold to the central bank and ask them, take your paper to the central bank and ask them for gold in return. The only people who could do that were central banks. So they were the only ones who could do it. So that gave the central banks a large margin of maneuver where, you know, as long as they didn't, as long as they didn't inflate too much, you know, their citizens couldn't ask for redemption of the gold. So then the inflation wasn't exposed a lot, or the bankruptcy, the default didn't need to happen. But of course, you can't cheat markets. Markets are just a reflection of underlying reality. So when more and more dollars were being printed, and in fact, the motivation for the dollar printing in the 60s was largely, it's always the same dynamic in the U.S., welfare and warfare. So you had the Vietnam War, and that needed financing because, you know, we had to fight wars all over the world, because that's just what... governments who have control of money, that's what they do. You know, the war is free for them, so they keep finding excuses for fighting more wars. And then welfare at home. So, you know, since we have a magic printing press that can satisfy all of our needs and things are costless, it's criminal not to give people free housing and not to give people free education and all of these pink ponies for the little girls and all of that stuff. If you refuse that, then you clearly hate the children. And so
that's certainly happening now. We're in this kind of quarantine. People can't access their jobs. They can't run their businesses. We've been told we can't run our businesses. We can't get to work. There's no paychecks. So now the government has given everyone a paycheck to not work. And the printing presses, the money printers are just creating all this money. So what does that look like? You talk about markets. So the market is going to keep up with all this new paper, and the prices of our basic and other goods are going to increase. Is that how the market responds?
Generally, yes. But I think, you know, it's I'm careful about making these kind of generalizations about short-term periods, because it gets a little bit more complicated when you look at how the banking system works. And currently, you know, the majority of the money supply is not created by the government or the Federal Reserve. It's created by banks, by issuing loans. And so, yes, the central bank is printing all kinds of enormous amounts of quantities of money and handing them over to bank. But we got to remember that on the other side, all of these banks are witnessing liquidations and bankruptcies and defaults, and all of that stuff is causing the money supply to decline. So it doesn't necessarily follow that, you know, we've doubled the money supply in the last few months, because even with all of these trillions that are being handed out, there are other trillions collapsing from the global dollar supply because of the global recession. But you know, in the 50s and 60s, things were simpler because financial system was far less sophisticated and it could create far less money. So it was it was much more of a money creation was far more in the hands of government and the central bank. And they, you know, prices began to rise in the 60s and 70s, but also price of gold began to rise. And so the US government could no longer redeem gold for other central banks at the price, because if they did, they would run out of their gold reserves. And so they decided that they would not redeem it. And this was offered initially as a temporary measure. You know, President Nixon said, we are just suspending the redeemability because all of these evil speculators are out there trying to, extort our national economy by speculating on prices and so on. But, it's been 49 years of this temporary measure. And since that time, you know, at that time, an ounce of gold was worth $35. Today, it's worth about $1,700. So it's gone up about 50-fold in about 50 years, which is impressive.
And at different times, governments have asked the citizens of their country to turn in their gold. I know that happened with FDR either leading up or during World War II. It happened in Germany.
1934, yeah.
People can only hold so much of this very hard, you know, currency that has a long-lasting, that provides long-lasting stability for them and their family that they invested in.
Yeah, I think this was really in the 1920s and 30s all over the world, and it may have originated in England during World War One. Well, not just England, but in Europe during World War One, a lot of those governments were confiscating gold and then forcing their population. Not necessarily forcing, but, you know, it was wartime and they were leaning on their population and, you know, in order to support the war effort, stop using gold and start using paper. We need the gold for the war effort. And this was really when it started. And this was why World War One went on for so long, because for the first time, central banks and governments and kings did not need to fight for as long as they had weapons and as long as they had money. They could continue to fight for as long as they could continue to print money. So initially, when money was gold, as a king, you had to collect money in taxes from your subjects in order to fight a war. And that's not easy, and it's not popular amongst your subjects. And if you do too much of it, then your population get angry at you and things go bad. But when you force your population to use paper, then you don't have to knock on their doors and ask them for taxes. You just keep printing more of the paper, and that devalues the paper that is in their hands. So you're able to rob them without having to go to their home. It's an incredibly convenient technology for impoverishing and robbing the population to finance the government. And that's really the story of the last century.
Thank you, Saifedean. So we are, I want to transition here to trying to understand what this Bitcoin, this blockchain, crypto, a currency based on cryptography, what that is. And I just want to start with a segue that people are opposed to using like a digital money. We don't understand what that is, but I think we are using digital money, right? We're not moving the money from bank to bank every time I pay my credit card, or so money isn't being, you know, flown around the United States to cover our purchases. We're really just moving data from these digital ledgers that our private banks are holding. So we're moving to digital currency. We're moving to a cashless. There's a strong push for a cashless society. So now we don't even have those IOUs and pieces and banknotes to understand where our money is, how we can get to it, and what its value is. So can you talk about how we are, where we are now in this sort of digital debting currency? And then please tell us what Bitcoin is and how Bitcoin solves this and potentially solves war and puts these limits on government and brings sort of individual.
Yeah. So in a nutshell, you know, what I was saying about the hardness of money, the fascinating thing about Bitcoin is that Bitcoin is the hardest money ever invented. Right now, it's at the same kind of level of hardness as gold. It's hard to tell which one is harder. Right now, they both grow at an annual rate of around 1.5 to 2%. With gold, it varies between 1.5 and 2. With Bitcoin, it's going to be around 1.8 or so per year. So it's not entirely clear which one is lower, but it is entirely clear that in 4 years' time, Bitcoin is going to be growing at a 1% supply growth rate. And the details of why can be seen in my book about explaining how the money supply growth. But currently it's at about 2%. Yep, there it is, the Bitcoin standard. Currently it's at about 2%, and it'll be at around 1%. So it'll be growing at a lower growth rate than gold within a year or so, within 3 years or so, four. And then the growth rate is just going to continue to decline. Eventually, Bitcoin taps out at around 21 million Bitcoins. That's the only amount of Bitcoin that will ever exist. There'll never be more Bitcoins than that. So,
but like gold, Bitcoin is fungible. We don't have to have a whole Bitcoin. We can take off, we can use small pieces of Bitcoin to transact.
Yeah, the way that Bitcoin grows is not that we make more Bitcoins to hand out to people. The way is that the value of Bitcoin goes up and people buy smaller and smaller pieces of it. So Right now, one Bitcoin is worth $10,000, roughly, or $9,000. 10 years ago, 1,000 Bitcoins were worth a dollar. So this is how the network goes from a network of five people to a network of tens of millions of people around the world. It's just they each get a smaller and smaller share, and the value goes up. So the fact that Bitcoin is out there, the fact that it can function, and for a various number of security reasons, which we don't really have time to get into, and you can read about it in my book, Bitcoin is pretty secure, and it makes sense to start considering the possibility that it will not go away tomorrow and that it might be sticking around for another few years, because it has been operating flawlessly for 10 years, 11. So maybe there's another 11, maybe there's another 100 in it. And if that is the case, if it continues to operate this way, I think the implications are enormous, because it's available for everybody anywhere in the world to access it. And so everybody has access to the hardest money ever invented. Everybody can store their wealth in a money whose supply cannot be inflated. And it's not just the hardest money ever, it's also the only strictly scarce money ever, which is amazing, because the only other thing that is truly strictly scarce is human time. The only thing that is completely fixed in its quantity in the world, as far as we're concerned, in our world, is our time, because everything else we can make more of. You know, so oil, gold, silver, whatever it is, we've been digging for those things for hundreds and thousands of years. And every year we find more than we found the previous year, because the earth is enormous, and you know, we barely scratched the surface of the earth. The size of the earth is about, the diameter of the earth is about 12,000 kilometers. And the biggest hole that anybody has dug anywhere is about 3 kilometers deep. So we've barely scratched the surface of the earth. The limit on how much of any resource exists in earth is not how much the limit of how much we can have of any resource is not how much of it exists in Earth. It's how much time we dedicate to it, as opposed to other uses. So we could have more of everything if we wanted to, but the cost is, and the limit is not that it's not there in Earth. The limit is how much time we have to dedicate to it, and therefore how much of other stuff we have to sacrifice. So we could produce so much more gold if we gave up on making cars and homes and all other things that we give up on, that we value. If we gave up on that and cared only about mining gold, we could make more gold. So the scarcity of everything else is relative, but the scarcity of Bitcoin is absolute. It's like human time. You can't make more human time, and you can't make more and you can't make more Bitcoin. So for me, this is just a match made in heaven, that you store the value. You know, your time is scarce. So when you work for, let's say, a day and you make $100, if you put them in the dollar, in the US dollar, next year there's going to be more dollars, and the year after there will be more dollar. In the long run, that $100 is going to be worth much less than it was worth when you first earned it. So effectively, the value of your work is eroding, because the supply of the thing in which you stored it is increasing. It's like you stored the value in a bucket that is leaking. Bitcoin is a bucket that has no leak. You know, there will never be more Bitcoins made than what is already predetermined.
And additionally, you've been talking about central banks and who's printing the money and loaning the money and going bankrupt. But Bitcoin is decentralized. There's no bank, there's no government. The government's trying to stand between, get in there somehow, but Bitcoin is decentralized. And the knowledge of where all the Bitcoin is in these multiple digital ledgers spread across whoever wants to join that community and participate in that. And that's the blockchain, that there's all these ledgers that are tightly latched. No one can get in there and change the numbers on the ledgers. And this is decentralized and overseen by, I don't know how many people are.
I think the key thing is that nobody controls it. So anybody can use it, and they can use it reliably, because it's trying to change Bitcoin, to try and change the supply, or try and change the rules so that your coins don't work, or to try and confiscate your coins, is practically impossible. We've got tens of thousands of Bitcoin users around the world running their full nodes, and each one of them needs to agree to any kind of change that happens in order for this change to take place in the Bitcoin protocol. So it's enormously secure in that regard. And more details are discussed about just how secure in this regard it is in my book.
Well, I'm going to share all the information for your book and for your website and how people can even study with you. You've started your own institute, and I'll share all of that below this podcast. So for the newcomer, and someone wants to invest in Bitcoin or hold Bitcoin or have this amazing currency, mm-hmm. Where do we start? What do we look at?
I think the most important thing is to really understand what it is that you're doing and understand the basics of the ownership. I think the most critical thing to know is the ownership of Bitcoin and how to secure the ownership of Bitcoin, because a lot of people can make a lot of mistakes, and Bitcoin is for real. It doesn't do do-overs. There's no customer service support. I think it's a mental shift to make from going in a world in which everything that you're using that is digital is just, you know, on a computer, and it's it can be sent and it can be received, and computer security for most people is something that is just an abstract problem where you essentially delegate it to others. With Bitcoin, you know, there are no do-overs, there's no customer service support. You have to think about it as if you're handling physical gold coins on the internet. And so if you have a physical gold coin and you drop it somewhere, there's no gold central bank you can call and tell them, please replace my coin. That coin is gone. If somebody takes it from you, it's gone. And the same thing you need to think about, you need to think in the same way about Bitcoin's private keys. And that's like a password that you need in order to access your coins. So I'd urge understanding what are the private keys. This is the most important aspect of it. And then looking into storage and how you're able to store Bitcoin in a safe and secure way. So this is, I think, the first step. And I'd urge, you know, start with something small to figure out how it works. To try out different storage arrangements and figure out how that works and see what works best for you, given your security needs and your security profile. And then, the next step is to try and run your own node so that you're part of the network and you can verify your own transactions. That way, you would not be reliant on anybody for using your Bitcoin.
We've given a lot of our trust, just an assumed trust, to our bank, to our government, for our money, that our money's safe, that it's holding its value, that we can get it when we want. And we understand that that's just not the case now. We understand money's being printed, our money's losing value. The time that I'm putting into my money, the value I think it has, it will be worth much less. That's a given now. So to start with Bitcoin, it's really a personal responsibility and an investment and a stake in looking after my own coins, my own wealth, my own future, safety and security of myself and my family and how I participate. Great. Thank you so much. Any final words, Saifedean? And then we'll see if we have any questions here.
I'd say, I think the, what could I say? Yeah, one word of advice. I think this can confuse a lot of people. If you're new into Bitcoin, you're going to be told about all kinds of different currencies, and you're going to be sold the story that Bitcoin has already gone up, and now the important thing is to go and look for the next Bitcoin and look for the next digital currency that's going to appreciate. And I think, you know, if I could give one piece of advice, is to be extremely skeptical of any of these things. If you want my opinion, and I've basically made my name in the Bitcoin space by being somebody who said this at a time when it was extremely, extremely unpopular. But over time, I have to say that I think it's, a lot of people have changed their mind and come to agree with me. In the digital currency space, there's only Bitcoin that is worth looking at. Everything else is at best, a high school experiment, but more realistically, it's basically a scam. And I think, you know, the key point is that the only reason that any Bitcoin is worth anything or any of these currencies is worth anything is the fact of its scarcity. If, you know, this is digital stuff, so you need a few lines of code in order to change the supply of any of these coins, and you can add a trillion new coins with a few lines of code in anything that's digital. You know, there's no physical cost toward the creation of it if you can change the code. The only currency for which that is not true is Bitcoin. Bitcoin is the only one, as we mentioned, it's the only one that nobody controls. It's the only one that nobody can mess with. That makes it a neutral protocol that nobody can control. And therefore, if you put your money into it, you're putting your money into something that you know cannot be devalued. But with all the other coins, and I think, you know, you can see more of a discussion of this in detail in my book, there are very clear reasons why it's patently clear that none of these coins can be claimed to be like Bitcoin in terms of it being not changeable. There is a small group of people that have controlled this coin and they can change it. And the details of how this happens are a little bit complicated, but ultimately, if there's a group of people that can sit in a room and change what goes on with your coin, then, you know, there's no value proposition there. It could fall apart in 15 minutes. And this is why, you know, people talk about different digital currencies, but in reality, there's only Bitcoin. The others exist in exchanges and they're being bought and sold here and there, and they can generate some kind of a fake volume by buying and selling. But in terms of actual real liquidity and people holding cash balances and being able to spend, the gap between Bitcoin and the rest is enormous. So I strongly urge you not to waste any time on that.
Thank you so much, Saif. I'm going to take questions for you on audio only. So if someone has a question, just unmute your audio. Thank you.
I have questions. I've heard many people in the US speak about how printing more and more money and increasing the money supply can go on indefinitely, so long as the US dollar maintains its global position and thereby continue to prop up the economy indefinitely as well. And what's your feeling about that?
I think I disagree. And I think the only reason people think this is the case is because the US dollar is growing on an international scale because it's much better than all the other national currencies, which are, you know, they inflate at a faster rate. So, you know, Venezuelans and people in Lebanon and in Zimbabwe and in Turkey and in Argentina, they're constantly demanding more and more dollars every day because they're watching their local national currencies get devalued. And, you know, they try and store their wealth in the dollar. So there will continue to be more and more. And of course, more importantly, perhaps it's the fact is that the dollar is the international currency of trade. So even if you wanted to hold on to your national currency, you can't use it for international trade. So you need to hold more and more dollars. And as international trade becomes more and more important, people need to hold more balances in dollars. So there's this runway, effectively, of value that can accrue to the dollar, but this obviously can't last forever. And you know, once that trend reverses, it has to reverse because, you know, if it continues, it'll eventually get to 100%, where the dollar is the only national currency that's anywhere in the world. And at that point, it won't be able to continue anymore, right? Because then nobody else is going to want to buy new dollars. So then, at that point, you know, there is a problem with this. More generally, I think, you know, the reason the dollar gets away with this is because we have economic growth that is probably causing a reduction in prices every year, because, you know, economic growth means we have more of everything. So every year we should be having 3, 4, maybe 5% reduction in prices of most goods and services, but we don't see that because the money supply is continuously expanding. But I think this is not sustainable, because the implication for the U.S. economy is that people don't really work or don't really need to work anymore. They just need to be connected to the central bank in one way or the other. They need to get low interest rate loans. Effectively, you know, if you can just get low interest rate credit, you can roll it over and that generates income. And so more and more people are not needing to work actual jobs because of this. And I think that the implication for the US economy is negative in the long run because, you know, people are not getting trained and not getting useful skills. And the, the US is, would effectively be falling behind economically in real terms. You know, it's nice if you can just print pieces of paper and export them. That sounds nice. But, you know, if you think about it on an individual level, if you did that yourself, eventually, you know, one of your children is going to not be able to continue to do that. And then they're going to face a very hard landing when they not only run out of printing money, but also need to learn useful skills to start being productive for others in order to make actual money. So, you know, I think you can't separate this from the many societal problems that you see in the US. I don't think you can separate them from the fact that so many people don't need to work. And I don't mean that in the perspective of the traditional way of looking at it. Poor people who are living off of welfare. I think that's an almost insignificant part of the problem. I think the real welfare problem is the corporate welfare and the welfare for the rich. That means that basically, if you have a lot of money, you know, the central bank will always buy your stocks and always buy your bonds and always make sure that those things are expensive and the price is high. And that comes at the expense of everybody else in the US and in the world. So, we can use government money in order to manipulate government statistics to look nice and impressive, but it becomes more and more absurd when you look at the actual real world, or you look at, you know, how Americans actually live, what Americans actually eat. You look at the state of American cities where, security is very low, crime is quite common, rioting as we see right now. You know, these are not the hallmarks of a wealthy society. And more, I think people are beginning to realize that, you know, having more impressive numbers every year in all of these aggregate metrics is not the be-all, end-all of human existence. So, you know, what good is the world's biggest GDP when you can't walk in the street of any major American city because you're worried about security? So I think the connection between the economic distortion of easy money and the economic problems and the social problems in the US and elsewhere, I think is something that that is the direct refutation of this claim that this thing can go on. But I think in the long run, we're going to see even more devastating consequences that refute even more. But don't expect the kind of people who care about the short run to care about the long run.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ammous. I'm going to wrap it up here. I want to be respectful of your time. And thank you for joining me here today. And you can learn more about Dr. Saifedean Ammous at saifedean.com. I'll put the information below this. And how to buy his book and read his book, also to join his institute and have an extraordinary, life-changing education. Thank you so much for joining me today.
My pleasure. Thank you so much, Kiki. Have a good day.
Thank you.